Hello, welcome to another edition of Frank Talk. Today we're having a very special episode because we are outside of the studio. Of course, I'm Desmond Utome, and I'll be talking to a very reputable member of the House of Representatives, a former journalist. He rose to the peak as an editor. He was with Leadership Newspaper, and he has been a chief whip of the State House of Assembly in Plateau State. And today, is the chairman of the Committee of Legislative Budget and Research. His name is Honorable Timothy Golu.
Welcome to my office.
Okay, Honorable, you're currently are the chairman of the Committee on Legislative Budget and Research. That appeared to be a new committee, maybe not in the previous house. Could you just take us through what your responsibilities are on this very assignment?
Thank you very much, my brother. The Committee on Legislative Budget and Research is actually not a new committee. The committee has been in the House here for the past, you know, two editions of the National Assembly, that is the 6th and 7th National Assembly. In fact, they gave birth to the committee in the 5th, you know, session of the National Assembly. And so it's not a new committee. Maybe probably because of the overlapping influence or overlapping influence of other committees or on this committee has made it to be a quiet one, but it has been working on the ground and you know, leading to the establishment of the National Assembly Budget and Research Office. You know, in the 6th Assembly, the committee oversight the establishment of the National Assembly Budget and Research Office, which was signed, a pass into law by both chambers of the National Assembly, but was not signed by the former president because of time and some other political problems, you know, issues. And even under Jonathan, that is Yar'Adua Jonathan regime, the bill was represented. It was passed into law again by both chambers of the National Assembly, but it was also not signed into law because of time. Under Obasanjo, the National Assembly submitted it 3 weeks to time. And because, of course, you know, there were problems with the Obasanjo administration because the National Assembly defeated his third-term agenda. And then this bill, because it is the brainchild of the National Assembly, it is the bill that seeks to strengthen the independence of the National Assembly, which obviously will not be too glaring, too pleasurable for the executive. And so Obasanjo refused to sign it. And because it was not up to 30 days for the National Assembly to come back and override through veto, in both chambers, you know, with the use of two-third majority. The same thing happened under Jonathan. In the case of Jonathan, it was submitted late again, 3 days to time. And because Jonathan did not even sign the constitutional amendment, you know, bill, not to talk of this one. And so that was the problem. That is why we decided to start early enough so that we will not have any problem like, you know, it happened in the last two editions. And as it is now, we've signed it into law. And then we, in fact, the two chambers have set up harmonization committees, and we are sitting on it right now as I talk to you. And any moment from now, we'll submit it to the president for his own assent. And so that is the history of the committee. It's not actually a new committee. It is a committee as strategic as any other committee. In fact, it's one of the five committees that sit on the MTF, midterm expenditure framework, and discuss on it, provide, you know, the analysis, and then bring it to the entire house. We jointly sit with the Committee on Finance, Appropriation, Aids and Loans, and National Planning. And so it has been did a very strategic committee of the house.
So what are we going to see? What should Nigerians expect once that bill is signed into law now?
Once that bill is signed into law, the strength of the National Assembly, the independence of the National Assembly, in fact, concerning the issue of budgeting, will be strengthened. As it is now, we rely on the executive, which we are not supposed to be, for budget information, for statistics, even though we should collaborate. But there are, you know, we as an oversighting agency or arm of government, over other arms of government, we are supposed to be ahead, not even at par, of other arms of government, because we make the laws and we represent an oversight. So if we are not ahead, we cannot give a good, you know, we cannot give a good account of our oversight responsibilities. And so we will now have a structure in place, you know, made up of experts that will give us timely, because that is the purpose of NABRO, to give timely, non-partisan, objective analysis of any economic or budget document. Mm. Anything that has to do with the economy. Once the president makes a pronouncement, once he takes up a policy, once it is a budget that is coming to the assembly, any form of policy that seeks to add value to the economy of the nation, it is the responsibility of the NABRO, because it's like a think tank that gives us the direction that, you know, explain to us, interpret what the executive is doing, so that we don't rely, as I said, on the Ministry of Budget of the executive. That is under the Ministry of Finance then. Now it is on its own. If the executive can develop, can upgrade its own budget unit to a department and then to a ministry as it is now, then it behoves on the legislature to move quickly to have its own budgetary think tank where we see that, because no arm of government, you know, do the budget. It's only the National Assembly, only the parliament. What the president brings, what the governor brings, what the executive brings, are just mere estimates. When it is referred to as a budget is when we have processed it through the legislative, you know, process, and then it becomes a law. That is when it is called a budget.
Okay, talking about strengthening the National Assembly and also giving you first-hand information about what the budget and economic policies are within the country. There is this particular problem. Most Nigerians have always observed in the National Assembly that the National Assembly, the executive, and the legislature are supposed to be working hand in hand in passage of the budget, both in terms of preparing it and passage, so that the whole process will be accelerated. How, to what extent would this also affect that?
You see, the problem is always with the executive. Always with the executive. The executive needs to have an orientation and a change of understanding concerning the parliament and the workings of the parliament as an institution. You know, that has been the problem. Because we are members of the same government, we must be partners in progress. We don't need to be confrontational. We don't need to fight to achieve a goal.
Do they see you as enemies?
Not as such, but because they don't understand, they see us as a hindrance. As a hindrance, we slow down the process of their own work. And it is not deliberate. That is democracy. Democracy has to do with the rule of law, due process, which also is built on the principles of separation of powers, checks and balances. So if there are checks and balances, you cannot sit down here and begin, you want to go to Lagos and you expect that you will not have, you know, a checkpoint on the road at all. You must have checkpoints. It's either the VIO you're checking your cars, or the road safety trying to control your speed, or, you know, the police trying to find out whether the vehicle is a stolen one. There must be checks and balances, which the executive is always not happy with it. That is democracy. It is not a one-man business. It is not a single-arm affair.
Why are you not comfortable with this?
I don't know, because, as I said, it slows down their own process, because the executive always has a mindset.
Yeah, but
you know,
the
kind of trying to put pressure, trying to dominate governance, because they control the funds, they control the security, so they are always having that mentality of dominance. For the legislature, it is the number one arm of government. It's not just the number one arm of government. It is the only symbol of democracy. Only symbol of the, without the legislature, there is no difference between the executive under a democracy or and the military or a monarchy. The difference is there is an institution, an organ that makes laws, oversight, and then represent through the due process. It represents people from various constituencies. The executive does not have that. The executive has one man with the vice president who are elected in peers, and then he appoints messengers. He appoints ministers. He appoints other people who advise him. For the legislature, no. We are a 360 man in the case of the House of Reps, and a 109, you know, man Senate, as in the case of the Senate. You know, and so all of us, 360 plus 109, in a parliament versus one or two persons in an executive. So you can see the wisdom of democracy. Those who make laws are more in number, because the process of making law is not an easy one. We need checks and balances. By the time somebody from your, you know, constituency comes in with his idea, and then somebody from his own constituency and my own, at least the probability that two good heads are better than one. Mm. Always strengthen, you know, a system. But when one person is allowed to, he becomes, you know, he becomes a dictator.
Like they say, power corrupt and absolute
exactly.
power corrupt.
So
absolutely.
That is the wisdom of democracy. Let there be people who are, if somebody has the power, if somebody has the money, let somebody has the power to authorize the use of this money. Then yeah. Let somebody choose.
I was going to ask, because if as executive, the president, for example, as the head of the executive, knowing fully well that he needs the money to be able to execute projects that will develop the people, and without the passage of the budget, he can't do this.
Yes.
Even though he has the power to do that up to 6 months of the year, but not exceeding half of the previous budget,
yes.
50%, yeah. Even though he has that very power. But the prompt, passage of the budget would definitely help his work also. If he recognizes this, why do you think that they are still very slow in presenting the budget?
They don't recognize this.
And also not carry you along in preparing that very budget. Because if you have access to the pre-information that is coming to you, you might be working already ahead.
You see, they don't want to see it from this point of view. That is why they have this problem. That is why they prepare the budget without the input of the legislature, which is flawed, is not proper. Because you will come back here and meet the same committees that will challenge or that will pose questions to what you are doing. Even before the preparation of the MTF, there is supposed to be a sectoral midterm review of the preceding or outgoing, you know, budget year. We are supposed to, for instance, the Ministry of Agri is supposed to organize a stakeholders within the whole industry so that you sit down and both the private and the, you know, the public sector sit down together to identify the challenges within the sector, because it is a single challenge. There is no challenge that is faced by the private sector that is different from if there is no food, both sectors are affected. If the prices of oil drop, both whether it is private company, oil companies, whether it is NNPC and the rest of them, we are all affected. So let us have an interact and engagement within that sector. Then you draw conclusions and then present them before the ministry at all these levels. Legislature should be involved so that they can be familiar with the issues. We cannot come and make laws without understanding the issues we are making the laws.
Or just rubber stamp the
exactly.
Proposal.
That is what the executive always want. Mm-hmm. They want to surprise us with the budget, announce to us that they are submitting budget on Thursday or on Friday. Then we wait for them, receive the budget, then they rush us, give us. No. The National Assembly or the Parliament cannot. Where the National Assembly becomes a rubber stamp, the whole country is in trouble and democracy is in danger. Because the wisdom of 400 and something people, as in the case of Nigeria, is more than the wisdom of two people. So when you come together, you sit down, the good idea brought by the president and his vice will be scrutinized by the legislature. Because even the president and the vice president have representatives who represent them at the level of the parliament. And they are at the level of the executive. We sit down and scrutinize. The constitution provides in section 80. There is the National Assembly, you know, authorize the use of funds is in the manner that it fits, in the manner that it deems fit. That means that the constitution recognizes that the National Assembly or the Parliament will not be made up of mad people who will come and do anything anyhow. No. If everybody that occupies, you know, the various positions in the different arms of government are expected to be sane people, then we should enjoy the confidence of other arms of government, especially the executive. We should also enjoy the confidence of the public, so that when they bring the budget, then we sit down. Going through the budget tells us, we will ask questions. You're talking about 6.6 trillion naira budget. How are you going to fund it? Are you going to have the money to fund it? If there are no funds, why budgeting for this thing? If you say you're going to rely on oil, what is the level of production? You talk about 2.2 million barrels a day. Is it achievable? Under is the situation we have in the Niger Delta. You know, the price of oil, $38 per barrel, as in the case of the 2016 budget, and now $42.50 per barrel, as in the case of the proposed 2017 budget. Is it realistic? What is the level, you know, the fluctuating price level? All these questions will be asked. At the end of the day, can this budget be a surplus budget the way we used to have? Or are we going to incur deficits? Because in the last few years, we begin to experience some deficit form of budgeting. Unlike before, when we operate the surplus budgeting system, at the end of every year, you see ministries, MDAs remitting unspent funds to the coffers of the federal government, which means that we used to have money. Mm-hmm. Now we don't have the money, which means that the budgets are always in deficit. As in the case of the 2016 budget, it's in deficit of about $2 trillion. So how are you going to get to borrow money? And in their own case, they said not just borrowing, foreign and local, but that they are going to rely on recovered loot state funds to augment the deficit in the budget, which is also dangerous. How are you sure you cannot price, you cannot negotiate monkey when it's still on the tree? Yeah. It's only when you catch the monkey that you begin to discuss how much you can sell. If you go and collect money from somebody that you are giving the person monkey and then you didn't catch the monkey, you will return the money.
Mm.
So the National Assembly sits down to analyze all these things, you know, to ensure that the predictions, the assumptions are realistic. And above all, because we represent the people, we must ensure a federal character in the application, the implementation of the budget. That is why the structure of the parliament, which has representatives all over, is the best in terms of allocation of projects. So when people talk about National Assembly should not get involved in projects and the rest of them, no, it is not right. Read the constitution. Government exists for the maintenance of law and order and to provide welfare. Government. It didn't say the executive exists for the, you know, to carry on with the welfare of the people. It's government. Is the legislature not part of government? Is the number one arm of government in a democracy? In a democracy. So why don't we cherish the responsibility bestowed on the parliament by the constitution? We are as it is now. There is no village that is not under a federal constituency or under a senatorial district that does not have a representative in this chamber. Two representatives, the Senate and the House of Reps. So when you give projects, when you allow for identification and allocation of projects under this system, it's even better. There is no minister that represents anybody. There is no advisor or ambassador that represents anybody. The president cannot be everywhere. So the president relies on this because we are elected like he is. We are elected on the same day, so under the same government.
Yeah, who seems to be more important in this case?
The legislature minister, is the number one arm of government, so yeah, that tells you.
The minister of budget, who has to prepare the budget, with the budget office and all that, and the minister of finance, and the National Assembly that will just scrutinize the proposal that is brought in. Who seems to be more important?
Let me tell you, the work of the legislature, all of them are important, but the work of the legislature ensures a balance. Because, as I tell you, two good heads are better than one. The Minister of Budget sits down to prepare it. He is not a representative. So the consciousness of representation is not there in him because his own is this place needs road and the rest of them. At the end of the day, you discover that 75% of road projects are located in one area.
In other words,
it is the National Assembly that draws the attention towards a federal character. We have to spread it. Everybody must be represented. You can't go there and then you discover that there are roads all over, you know, one area and then other. What do you tell your people? Why are you here? Why are you representing them? Let's be realistic.
And that is why they have to carry you, the members of the National Assembly.
We have to, not that they have to carry us. We are automatic partners in progress. This is government. It is not government of the executive. It's government of the people. And then, if we say government of the people, for the people and by the people, which one looks closer to that divination for you between the executive and the legislature? It's the legislature. How many people are elected under the executive? It's larger than the it has a larger bureaucracy than that of the legislature. But the legislature is made up of people elected.
Yeah, but this takes us to that very point where you want to reconcile what happened recently in the National Assembly, particularly in the House of Reps, whereby the former chairman of the Appropriation Committee said that the budget was padded. So many people believe that the National Assembly does not have that right to, in quote, mutilate the budget. If it is brought to the National Assembly, having been consciously prepared by the executive, it should just be checked, allocate funds to this very project, and you pass it. But with what happened recently, how do you possibly reconcile this?
Let me tell you, it was just an attempt, you know, it was just an attempt to blackmail the National Assembly by a madman who feels that he has been displaced because he wanted to unilaterally do the work that the parliament is supposed to do. Jibril Aminu is not the National Assembly. is not the House of Representatives, and he cannot be the House of Representatives. He is only but a unit of the National Assembly that has a specific responsibility, just like any other unit that make up the entire, you know, House of Representatives. He tried to, he padded the budget in his own language. He padded the budget. The National Assembly dealt with him because he padded the budget. He came out, went to the media. He has not told you how the budget was padded. He keeps talking about corruption. He keeps talking about padding. It is the media that aided people like him to get to this. You know, okay, look at it now. What is the essence of the allegations? What is the essence of the media attention on such a mad person? Nothing. He only succeeded in trying to ridicule the parliament that belongs to all of us, that make laws for this country. He is the one that, if I tell you, if I identify the areas of the distortions, the man went and tapered, like our own case on the plateau, he deducted monies meant for our own projects, 12 million naira from the 8 of us and even our senators to go, you know, to create a subhead which does not exist in the budget, or to add it to an existing subhead somewhere illegally.
Does he have
that? As members of the House of Reps from Plateau, we are supposed to identify projects worth about 119 million naira from Plateau State.
Each?
Yes, to identify projects for the implementation by the executive. Then the man went and deducted. Who gave him the right to do it? It's illegal. So he has distorted our own projects, constituency, you know, projects. He has done that to most of our own colleagues everywhere. Why? And then he decided to transfer illegally some funds meant for implementation of other projects under different subheads to other ones. He single-handedly sat down and do that. Even the Speaker does not do things alone in the National Assembly. Even the Senate President does not do things alone in the National Assembly. Then somebody who has the responsibility to coordinate, his work is to coordinate other committees. Every committee has the independence of sitting down to take submissions from different ministries. Once you agree, because he is not more than those who are there. He is not made the chairman of appropriation because he has PhD or is a professor of appropriation studies. No, he is just the trust that the leadership has in him that he can handle, you know, this work, which he failed woefully. Now he distorted the 2016 budget. He took the intervention of the leadership to set up another committee headed by the Right Honorable Deputy Speaker who rectified the distortions. But of course, you know that the budget is a bulky document.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the minor, you know, problems that were still there because of time. The executive did not submit the budget or the estimates to us on time. And so definitely we have to take time to scrutinize it. The National Assembly saved the 2016 budget. If not for the National Assembly, the 2016 budget would not have been implementable because of the distortion. You will find out from MDS, they will put an item, media, 50 million, information, 30 million, advocacy, enlightenment, publicity. What, as a journalist, what is the difference between these words? Is that no fraud? They put it, so we come and collapse it. My friend, what do you mean by publicity, enlightenment, advocacy, sensitization, information, and the media? They are all the same thing. Go to the ICT section. You will see they will put ICT, they will put Facebook, they will put infrastructure, they will put all this one that has to do with one thing. Mm-hmm. The National Assembly rigorously and vigorously take its, sometimes up to 9-10. We are working here. You go back home, you go through it, because they will bring bulky documents to you like this, thinking that you don't have time to go through them.
Mm.
So that by the time you know, you just pass something. No. Under this leadership, especially the leadership of the House of Representatives, which I belong to, the Speaker himself sit down to read every document, word for word, every paragraph. That is why he is leading by example. He sits down to read it. And then by the time we are making contribution, he is aware of every page. By the time you are submitting it, that is true leadership. He is also concerned about it, because if anything happens, he'll be held responsible. So he had to discipline himself to see, you know, if you go to the Senate, it's the same thing. The leadership of both the Senate and the House of Representatives are so conscious of this. That is why we don't want to give room to any public blame. We sit down to do it. So we expect the Nigerian public to commend the National Assembly. Where there are misunderstandings, you ask. People should pay attention to the National Assembly. Let them have interest in the National Assembly. Then they will understand what we are doing. They don't pay attention to it. That's why there are misunderstandings. That's why there are misrepresentations. That's why whenever issues of budget padding comes in, everybody starts talking about the issues they don't know. There is nothing like padding the budget by the National Assembly. We have the power. We cannot steal our own property. Mm. You cannot steal your trouser. It's your trouser.
Yeah.
So we have the right to do it. Unlike what you said, when they come, our own is just to sit down. No, it is not. Our work is even more strenuous because it takes 1 minute for somebody to prepare and write something. It takes 10 minutes for somebody to go through what the other person took 1 minute to do. It's easier to destroy than to build.
Yeah, that's true.
This house, cannot be built in 1 day, but it can be destroyed in 1 day.
Yeah, I was going to ask this. If they talked about padding, and of course, you have said that he is the one who is guilty of the padding, if it existed at all. If you talk about padding, what power does the National Assembly have to substitute a project, for example, maybe by the entire house? What right do they have to impute a project that possibly may not have been included by the executive when they were presenting the budget as a proposal?
Yes, our own is, if you bring in a project and to us the project is not viable, there is need to concentrate on other areas for the interest of the nation. We will advise accordingly. We can remove it.
Can delete it.
Yes.
And you can bring in a fresh one that possibly...
We don't sit down to bring in new projects. The executive, because we restrict ourselves to the wisdom of bringing the estimates.
Yeah.
We sit down and restrict ourselves to it. If you bring in water projects, for instance, or road projects, and then the concentration is on one side, or we feel that the number of boreholes that are needed by that area or the nation, more than what you bring, or they are less, then we take a decision on it. No, we're not supposed to have it. We need roads, but the item must be there in the budget for us to sit down and discuss.
Overall, is the right of the National Assembly
exactly.
To ensure that whatever is in the budget is what should benefit the populace.
Exactly. That okay. is why we take into cognizance the importance, the value of that project, and then the cost of it, and then the reality of achieving that project, not just for the pleasure of it, or not just for the political, a purpose of it, that you bring in a project that you want to impress people and at the end of the day, you don't do it. No, we want projects that can be implemented. We want projects that will go around because everybody is the same here. Every community is the same. We want things to go well. In fact, we want the budget to be implemented to the point that everybody will benefit. Under the what we call dividends of democracy.
Just briefly, how does your committee, to what extent will your committee help correct these anomalies? Because the impression outside there is that you don't have any power, you don't have any right. The National Assembly is just there. They're just there to distort the budget that was presented, proposal that was presented
you
by
see,
the executive.
It's not that the
to what extent
don't know.
Would your
most of the people saying
this?
So are not. It's not that they are ignorant. But they are just trying to politically ridicule the National Assembly. Some of the people lost elections, to members who are serving in the National Assembly. So anything, have you ever seen anybody pressing, taking their time to press the National Assembly for what it has done? The president just submitted a request for loan. The Senate threw it out. Nigerians are yet to commend the Senate. In the House, we're going to also reject it. Nobody has taken his time to say, we are commending. But if it were something in the negative, you would have been hearing it. If it were wardrobe allowance, if it were, this and that, furniture allowance, if it were this, it would have been headlines. And the media would have given due attention to it. But why is it that we are not? This is one of the most important decisions that the National Assembly has, taken to save this country. And yet nobody is saying, anything. Our own is not just to come and we have the constitutional responsibility. As lawmakers, we are very conscious of the laws that are in place. We don't do anything outside the law. We just don't do, because we will be the first. We challenge Nigerians to just, always come up and tell us where we are going wrong.
I wanted to just know in very clear terms how your committee will be able to help
correct this. Our committee is doing a lot because we analyze.
Yeah.
When we analyze, we give our own analysis as whether it is realistic, for instance, to achieve the exchange rate fixed for 2017 budget. An exchange rate of 219 naira to $1. To us, it is unrealistic. Because even as of now, officially, it is more than that. For the benchmark of $42.50 per barrel, yes, the fuel price keeps going up, you know, and down, and the rest of them. So we analyze and give our own advices. This one is realistic. It can be achieved. This one cannot be achieved. Let's do a reasonable budget, a budget that can be implemented. As it is now, we're talking about implementing the 2016 budget. They are complaining of funds. Mm. And yet, the proposal for this year, for the budget, may even be more than 6 trillion. So what? Why? When we cannot fund the 6 trillion budget in the 2016 budget estimate, why are we trying to go beyond? Is it just, you know, for the fun of it? No. In my own committee, we do that. And then the national, we submit it to the National Assembly. Once the National Assembly approves it, the two chambers submit it to the president through the special advisors here. And they see what we have been doing. The office that we oversee, that's the National Assembly Budget and Research Office, also, you know, does the mapping of projects. As it is now, if you open the book, it is somewhere here. We do the mappings according to geographical, exactly, geopolitical zonal basis. Mm. In the south, locate your state, Edo State, your local government. You see the projects that were already estimated for implementation in your place. Once you carry that book, you go to the website of NABRO, you see there. So if you're supposed to have a borehole or a road project in Uromi, for instance, you already know it. You see it on that book. You see it on the website. If it is not done, you can challenge. This project was part of the 2016 budget that was supposed to be implemented in your place, and you didn't see it. You don't need anybody. Nigerians should go through the budget document. You will see everything there. The National Assembly does not go outside what is in the budget.
How come most Nigerians are not aware that there is
we such, have been talking through this media like this, but people don't give attention. People don't give attention to it.
Maybe you should give more attention.
Former President Obasanjo said, if you want to hide something from Nigeria,
put it in writing.
Put it in writing. So you can't blame the National Assembly. People should read the thing and see it. The budget is the number one document after the Constitution. Why can't we be interested in it? Let us know the projects, what the National Assembly is doing, even what the presidency is doing. The government is trying to provide, you know, facilities, infrastructure for our places. If you don't know, somebody who is asked to go and implement and do a project in your place may not do it, collect the money and the thing, and then nobody knows. At the end of the day, you are complaining that you need roads, you have not been given that. Meanwhile, it's there.
Yeah, but sometimes you want to get some of these budgets. Some people have complained of not having access to the budgets.
No, it's not. It is not true.
Maybe the soft copy, maybe online, I don't know.
The safe copy is always on the website of the National Assembly. And then even if you cannot get it on the, you know, larger website of the National Assembly, the NABRO, we've been talking about, we've appeared on, you know, media sensitization campaigns to talk about this NABRO, to talk about it, get the email, the web address, and then you can go through it there. There is no way you can ask your representative to bring a copy. Definitely we will give it to you so that you can help us use your own this thing,
okay,
you know, your medium to sensitize.
Yeah, because they need to be aware. If they don't have it, they will not be able to use
every
it.
Time
but we will put it out to the public to ensure that they have it.
Every time the communities should be able to ask their representatives, should be able to call their representatives to give them briefs. If you send somebody to go to the National Assembly, you can have, if you don't have access to him, there is a way you can have access to the National Assembly to get this basic info. We have civil society organizations like PLAC, CISLAC, and the rest of them, very reputable civil society organizations that work with the National Assembly. They can also be reached so that all these things, you know, they know everything about the National Assembly. They can pick the copies. They can get the information. But our people are not reading. That is why we are always quarreling. They will say, this thing is supposed to be in the budget. This thing is not supposed to be. The only way out to settle the rift is to pick the budget. If it's there, you know. If it's not there, you know. So why wasting time and energy.
Okay, to round off on this very segment, what exactly is the relationship between your own committee and the appropriation committee? Where do you draw the line?
We work together. Our own, as I told you, is to provide timely, objective, non-partisan, you know, correct and, you know, analysis of budget documents or economic policies of government through NABRU, that is the National Assembly Budget and Research Office, which is an equivalent, we've passed into law now, of the Congressional Budget Office in the USA or the, you know, Scrutiny Office in the UK or other of, you know, they exist now. All democracies are trying to have those parliamentary budgetary structures for their own listing. The Committee on Appropriation appropriates funds, appropriate or sits down to relate, to compare and contrast, you know, the assumptions and the realities of the estimates with what is on ground. If a road project is supposed to cost 1 billion naira, you know, it is the appropriation committee that determines the viability of that project at the end of it all, because a committee, the Standing Committee on Agri, for instance, or works, may recommend something, you know, agree with the ministry that yes, this project is viable, this one, you know, may not be viable. At the end of the day, all other committees appear to give account of all that they have done with the other committees, you know, before the appropriation committee, which is the mother of all committees, sits down and defend it. Why do we approve this road project for the Federal Ministry of Works? Why do we approve that NEMA should provide this and the rest of them? So you defend it. So at that level, again, there is another engagement. So you can see the process. So when the appropriation committee is not convinced of the viability of the project, it has the right to remove the project. It has the right to remove the project, but not by one man, like what Abdul Mumin did. He decided to do the budget alone, which is illegal. He's supposed to be arrested and prosecuted because he distorted the budget of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. And then some Nigerians are supporting him. Some Nigerians see, you know, because it is an allegation of corruption. So anything politics, any political institution is always facing that. But Nigerians should be patient enough to give close attention to whatever allegation that comes up. He lied against the speaker. The speaker has never, let me tell you, the speaker has never shown interest in anything. He respects everybody. The speaker will always throw it up in an executive session. What is happening? What are the issues? This man would not even attend executive sessions to even brief members. Members wanted him out. The speaker was trying to provide a soft landing for him. When it became so burdensome on him, the leadership had to relieve him. That was when all these allegations started. Then there was a diversion from what the man did. The media should take its time, find out what the man has done vis-a-vis what he is saying. If you go to an agency and then the head of the MDA is telling you something, there are rules establishing every agency. As a media, we have to go check the rules, whether there are violations of the rule by the person operating them or by somebody outside, whether there are infractions even by the players within the system. But when we just listen to somebody, somebody can just sit down and be talking anyhow, and then we now give him credence because we feel that this is politics, and we will not allow democracy to grow. We will not allow the parliament to grow to do his best. We must give respect to our own parliament. It is our parliament. And there is nobody that stays here in this parliament for life. Tomorrow it will be you. Tomorrow it may be him. So if we pull down this house, tomorrow there will be no house for somebody to come and sit down and make laws. The fact that somebody is here today should not make the difference. That because it is somebody, let us pull down the house. No, we must do everything to see that we promote and, you know, promote and encourage our legislature so that we can catch up. We have, in fact, some of the best brains globally in the legislative field in Nigeria. Listen to some of our colleagues here, and then you will understand that yes, they are out. They are out for this job. Forget about the monetary aspect and the rest of them. Well, of course, you have to be paid to do your work. People don't talk about those who work in the NNPC. People don't talk about those who work in the CBN, how much they get. People don't talk about anything. Okay, those who work in the local government, if they begin to complain that no, we must have, and they've been complaining, those who work in the local government, we need to have the same salary structure with those who work at the federal level, with those who work at the state level, with those who work with the NNPC, the CBN, and the rest of them. Why is that yet to be implemented? Why? We must have a uniform. In fact, everywhere, even in the national, if you have the same degree, wherever you are, you should be paid remuneration according to your level. So that, you know, those of us who are, you know, at this level will also be paid in that same way. Then whatever responsibility that is given to you, you must be given something for that work. If there is no office, as it is now, there is no director in the ministry that does not have a running course.
Mm.
There is no principal. There is no headmaster that does not have a running course. But when it comes to the National Assembly, why do they have running costs? So how do we do the work? If I go for oversight.
Anyway, since the members of the National Assembly are the representative of the people, and they are the closest people to the grassroots at the federal level, perhaps that is why the people always come back attacking you, wanting to put you under pressure to get those developments given to them. But we'll continue on the integrity of the budget and funding of it when we return from this very short break. Don't go away. Okay, you're welcome back, and Honorable Timothy Golu is still with us. Sir, you've spoken about the assignments the National Assembly does in trying to ensure that the budget is passed in the interest of Nigeria. Are you then saying that the President should commend the efforts of the National Assembly by scrutinizing the budget to ensure that this budget has integrity at all times?
Then the National Assembly gives integrity to the budget. When the President brings it, before the President brings the budget or presents it before the National Assembly, nobody is aware of the budget. Nobody knows the details and the contents of the budget. It is not even called a budget. Nobody knows the details of the estimate. It is the National Assembly that opens the box, that box that was presented by the President, and then tells Nigerians, you know, the contents of that budget. It is a bill, like any other bill. The day the President brings it is the first reading. The day we discuss it, the general principles of the budget, whether the budget has to do with diversification, whether it is a budget, you know, of transformation, whatever it is, we talk about it generally, and then people make observations. Then it is committed to the committees. Every committee will go and sit down and attend to the MDAs that are under the oversight functions of those committees. That is the public hearing, because we engage those who come in. They bring their own. If it's an ordinary bill, or any other bill, which is different from a money bill, you call people to come and sit down and, you know, you engage yourself in discussions. This is the semblance of the public hearing. You sit down, you allow people to come and defend it. It is shown, the media is always there, you know, so that you listen to the submissions. We ask questions, the viability of this project and the rest of them. It is after the National Assembly has concluded its job, you know, and we pass it into law, that it becomes a budget signed by the President. So through this process, the National Assembly goes through it. You know, that's why we have committees. One single committee cannot handle all the responsibilities. The Committee on Finance will handle the budgets of, you know, organizations like the FIR, you know, Federal Inland Revenue Service, and other relevant organizations under it. The Committee on appropriation oversight the service-wide votes. The Committee on Agri oversight other, you know, agencies under it. And then we all bring the various submissions together, and then we go through them again. The committees will go through their work. Definitely they must be conversant with what they have discussed, what they've agreed upon, what they've removed, what they've added with the committee or with the MDA. It is not done in secret. So there is nothing that is done here that somebody will go back and then insert a figure, he goes back to collect. How do you do that? There is nothing like that in the National Assembly. If anything happens like that, it's a fraud. And if it is a fraud, then it starts with the executive. How can a member of the parliament who does not award contract, who does not participate in tender, who is not even supposed to know who is going to execute the program, except if it's not executed, then you shout, you go back, and then there are allegations that members came and who allowed the members to go there?
Yeah, but there are some of these allegations.
How do they get access to it?
These allegations that sometimes some National Assembly members come to the the civil service and ask them to impute certain things into the proposals before they even come to the National Assembly.
if they will go back and collect this as
content. Let me tell you, if a legislator does that and then he gets away with it, who is supposed to be blamed? Who is supposed to be the police of this process? Where does it start from? It is always, you know, members of the MDA that, you know, create this type of temptatious things to any other member who even may do it. Let me tell you, most of these allegations are not true. Because it looks like tales by moonlight. There are legislators who are already established people, who have been members of the MDS, who have headed this MDS, who have been members of the executive, who understands, you know, the processes there and the rest of them. So if they come with any idea, and then you, who is presently handling affairs there, who is supposed to protect the integrity of the budget, you know, decide to open your arms to it, then you should be the one to be arrested. How do you allow somebody who does not have a responsibility to play in your office, come in to play your role?
One area that this has been very, very widely reported is the area of constituency projects. Nobody says, okay, fine, it is my project. I will also decide who implements that project, what contract, I mean, a company.
You see?
Are giving the award letter to execute that very project.
You see why members are always keeping an eagle eye on such projects is because of the corruption that members of the MDA impute in the implementation of this budget. Sometimes they don't even do it. And you don't get to know who is supposed to do the project. As a representative, what do? You have a road project in your place, and then other roads are being constructed, then your own is lying fallow or is lying there. It is the people will ask you, because nobody knows the contractor. It is you that will find out. That is the reality. And then sometimes the executive, let me tell you, when it has to do with training, they don't do the training, or they do shoddy work in the name of training, and then they just go and report that they have concluded the training. At the end of the day, you come and meet your people and nobody is aware of what he or she has been taught the previous day. So it is the responsibility of the legislature to ensure that these things are done according to the mandate specified in the award of the contract. Doing that does not mean that you are going back, you know, to tamper with what somebody is supposed to do and the rest of it. If that is the case, why are they not blowing the whistle? Why are they not reporting? They will sit down there, it is after everything, then they will come and be talking and be saying all manner of things. No, it's not right. If any legislator comes back to do what is illegal, you have the responsibility to raise an alarm if you yourself is not corrupt.
Well, the National Assembly has also been accused for being responsible for the seemingly poor implementation of the 2016 appointment.
How?
What would you say?
How?
Yeah, because they said that the funding has not been allowed. The executive said he wants to borrow some money to ensure the implementation.
What has this
also,
bond?
The project was not passed on time.
What has this bond, this funding of the budget, got to do with the loan that they are proposing? When are they proposing to get the loan? Last month, they brought in a request that they want to. So how many months to the end of the year? How many months? Let's be realistic. This borrowing should have nothing to do with the 2016 budget, because there were assumptions in the preparation of the MTF and then the budget of 2016. We are waiting for the implementation. That's why we raise issues. These ones, are they realistic? These ones are not realistic enough. Let us face the reality. They said no. So we allow them. Now they are coming back to what the National Assembly has said. We drew their attentions to the realities and otherwise of the contents of the budget. They said no. Now they are coming back to it. And in the first place, is it the responsibility of the National Assembly to present the budget or to prepare the budget? We wait. As it is now, we are waiting for the budget. They have not come with it. So how do you blame the National Assembly? How do you blame the National Assembly, for God's sake? There is no constitutional provision that says the National Assembly should hasten the executive to accelerate action on the public, the same public that used to put pressure on the National Assembly to pass the budget in time. Where are they? Where are those voices? The people are not talking to the executive to prepare and submit the budget. Look at the MTF that they brought, the midterm expenditure, and then the fiscal strategy paper that is supposed to be a guide to the budget. There was no mention of this loan inside. That's why we say the MTF is deficient, is highly deficient, because there was anything outside the MTF
it should not be part of the budget.
This particular MTF, exactly. 2017?
This budget, this MTF 2017 budget, because we have already passed the 2016 MTF, even with the budget, we are waiting for implementation. But the 2017 budget should start with the MTF, and everything inside the budget, the MTF gives guide. It's like a compass to the main budget that is coming. So if you want to bring a different budget from the MTF that you have submitted, then it means you are misleading the nation. The economy focus is also flawed because it is guided. The pilot sometimes put the plane on an autopilot because he has set it okay, and then it will fly on its own. If you don't do it like that, and it is based on the MTF prepared by the pilot himself, you cannot not just set the things, put every structure right, then the plane will just go on autopilot. No, the plane will crash. So why is the MTF different from the main budget?
But how comfortable are you with the implementation level of the 2016 budget so far?
We should be asking the executive, because we don't implement the budget.
But you oversight the budget.
We oversight the budget, exactly. We are oversighting them, and then they keep talking about no funds for implementation. They don't have money. Ministries will be complaining that they are waiting for money. We have 2 months to go. We have 2 months to go, even though it's likely going to extend. The budget year is going to extend to next year, as we did last year, because of the late presentation of the budget. But whatever it is, let's say we have 5 or 6 months to go. The budget should have been implemented more than 15% by now. But it is not so. We are waiting. What is the problem? We expect Nigerians to be asking the executive what is happening. The slow pace of release of funds, as it is now, they have not also submitted this yet, you know. We should accelerate action on that so that the National Assembly can sit down. Let us do things, you know, take things from the realistic point of view so that we make the work very easy for the National Assembly. If we have been working together, we will always understand ourselves better. During budget defense sessions, we will not have much questions to ask, because we start together and we will continue together. We'll be familiar with most of the issues in the estimate of the presentation. If we don't understand, if we are not on the same page, we cannot be on the same page. Once we come, we'll be asking questions that were supposed to have been addressed at the initial stage, you know, even before MTF is prepared. We should be part of it. Let's sit down together and discuss. We have not been discussing together. That is why we wait for them here. When they come, we ask questions. And they say the questions are strange. They are strange because we don't know the document you are bringing. So we have to ask questions. You cannot stampede us not asking questions.
I think there's a part of the law that requests or requires the executive to brief the National Assembly.
Exactly.
At the various
in the fiscal responsibility
at the yes. implementation. To yes. what extent is they this? They have not been
doing
followed?
It. They have not been doing it.
But has the National Assembly been calling for this briefing?
You see, the National Assembly is very, very careful with it because of a precarious political situation we are in. That's why, because of the public pressure, we don't demand for some things to be done. Because if we begin to ask questions, they say you don't like the executive.
It's not really like hamstrung in terms of oversighting the executive.
Exactly. The National Assembly is competent enough, and the National Assembly has been doing it. If not for the oversight, so many things would have gone wrong. Let me tell you, so many things would have gone wrong. But because I as I'm telling you, there is a political limit to which we feel we should go, so that Nigerians will not think that we don't want this government to succeed. Because if we work, the National Assembly is a very powerful arm of government. Yeah, if it is to implement or to exercise all its functions, I am telling you, we cannot pass the budget within a reasonable time for the executive to implement. Because when you have the power to oversight, it means that you require the same structure that prepares the budget to oversight. If they have engineers and surveyors who prepare, who do the design of roads, then we should also have our independent structure, which NABRO is supposed to have, so that we can go and ascertain it. If you tell me that doing borehole there is 500,000 naira, it's left for me to go and see whether it is as realistic as that. In that case, I need the same structure, which means that we need more funding in the National Assembly to be able to do that. If not, we will continue to discuss budgets at, you know, majorly
the political level.
Well, talking about the limitations you people in the National Assembly have in trying to exercise your power, full weight of your power on oversighting the executive, don't you think that if the law has given you such power, it's required you to actually use the same power in the interest of the people? And if you are not using it, then it is going against the
interest of the people. Are we not using it in the interest of the people? Are we not? How many times, if you have been following, if Nigerians are following, you will definitely know that the National Assembly has saved this. Just recently, a member of the House raised a motion on the need to recover about $3.8 billion or so that is in the hands of 20 individuals through AMCON. They borrowed money through their companies. They refused to pay. Why? It's the National Assembly that is revealing and exposing. Look at, go through the motion papers. Even motions of public national importance. Is it not the National Assembly doing this thing? Are we not exposing corruption? Are we not deterring those who also want to do it? We are not ghosts. We are not spirits. We do them as we stumble on them or as information is provided to us. Just like the security people, they are not angels. If you don't give security people information, there is limit in what they can do.
Yeah, I asked that question because you said that you couldn't visit the full strength of your power on the executive by oversight because of some political reasons, and people will be complaining that you are antagonistic.
Exactly.
Yeah, but they, even at that, people still see the National Assembly as antagonistic because recently the president, there were reports that the president wanted some emergency power to take Nigeria out of this economic recession, and it was resisted. Do you think the president deserves?
As you are speaking to me now, can you tell me the powers that the president require to, you know, outside the box? Can you just tell me, since you are speaking for the president now, tell me which powers you think he needs to do abracadabra that will bring out Nigeria out of this, you know, this recession? Tell us. It's not just to talk about it. Give us the areas that he needs these powers. If it is to amend the law of procurement, which he said delays the award of contracts, this is not a new law. This is just an amendment. You amend the law so that instead of taking 6 months, you know, you spend like 1 month for every activity, you know, every procurement process to be completed so that the project can be awarded. That's all.
So that was a misplaced priority.
You know, we don't even know what we are talking about. As far as we are concerned, there are enough laws that will help the presidency to implement whatever he wants to implement now. There is no area of any human endeavor in Nigeria that does not have a law. If we don't have a law somewhere, there is always a doctrine of necessity that the president can always call on the National Assembly to give him. Mm-hmm. And the National Assembly will do it. So as far as I'm concerned, we are not aware of any law that he needs that we did not give him. Which are the... tell us the laws. Tell us the laws. Then we cannot talk about it. We don't know the laws. There is no law that is abstract. There is no law that exists behind the papers. Every law is documented. So tell us the law.
Thank you very much, Honorable Timothy Golu. He is of the opinion that the president requires no emergency power to ensure that the country is moved out of recession. It's been a wonderful time with Honorable Timothy Golu in his office. It's a very different kind of presentation today because we were doing this outside of the studio. Until we come again your way next time, this is Frank Talk with Desmond.